Hello and welcome to Film Companion South. Today we're going to be talking about Sye Raa Narasimha Reddy, written and directed by Surender Reddy and starring megastar Chiranjeevi. Now, in the pantheon of aging yet ageless stars of the South, Chiranjeevi occupies a special place. Rajinikanth is still active on screens. He still comes up in far more movies than he used to even a decade ago. Mammootty and Mohanlal, they seem to be in a movie practically every week. But Chiranjeevi, apart from the occasional Khaidi number 150, he has not been on screen. He has been MIA. So you can see why Ram Charan, the producer, was drawn to Sye Raa Narasimha Reddy. It is not just a vehicle for his father, it is a monument to the megastar. From many accounts, the title character was one of those chieftains or governors who were amongst the earliest to revolt against the British. But if that's the story you're after, then you're better off reading a history book. Because this film is really about the agelessness of this particular aging superstar. It really should have been called Konidela Shankara Varaprasad. There's one glorious visual, truly glorious visual, where the hero's head appears to be replaced by the sun, and it is the film's most fitting visual. Expectedly, everyone else around Chiranjeevi is reduced to a small planet orbiting around him. Amitabh Bachchan, for instance, plays a cotton beard. Vijay Sethupathi plays a guessing game with the audience, because from the writing it's not clear what he's doing and it's up to us to guess what he's doing in the film. Nayanthara plays the wife. Her character arc in the entire first half goes something like this: look pretty, get married, get pregnant. The other stars like Sudeep, Nasir, Jagapati Babu, Ravi Kishan and Anushka Shetty, who plays the Rani of Jhansi, collect the easiest paychecks of their lives. So it's really up to Chiranjeevi to shoulder the sprawling, actually too sprawling for its own good narrative, and that he does with charm and magnetism. So this is how you separate the men from the boys. If one of today's actors had performed this underwater decapitation that happens in this movie, you would have laughed with disbelief. But when one of the old school stars do it, when Chiranjeevi does it in this movie, it practically seems like the most natural thing to do. The head of the decapitated person, it pops up like a champagne cork and the audience cheers. But even the biggest star needs the gravity of a strong screenplay, and that is where Sye Raa falters and ultimately fails. Apart from Chiranjeevi, there's nothing holding things together, and there's nothing that differentiates this Rise Against the British saga versus the many, let's say, villages Rise Against the Evil Landlord masala movies we've seen over the ages. The Narasimha myth is invoked, but nothing comes of it. There's the idea, very interesting idea of a people's movement, but again, nothing comes of it because the focus is so much on the hero. Where are we going to go and get a people's movement? There's no sense of chronology, of character, or even of geography, which should surely be more than just a bunch of place names that are thrown on screen as title cards. Narasimha Reddy is everywhere at once. He's there when his wife is kidnapped. He's there when some random villager is persecuted. He's there when some random house burns down. It's like he's everywhere at once, and I half wondered if he'd been bitten by a radioactive spider during one of his jungle jaunts. Now, at the beginning of this film, we are given the disclaimer that cinematic liberties have been taken with this narrative. So why not compress the many British villains into one very strong antagonist? Why not compress the many indistinguishable forts into one impregnable stronghold around which the battles are staged? Why not try to do more things with fewer people so that the characters aren't just a fancy dress parade of big names? Some questionable CGI apart, the physical scale of the film is huge, thanks largely to cinematographer R. Ratnavelu, but the emotional scale is very, very small. Brothers and sons appear and disappear as though by magic, and we are asked to invest in their arcs. There's a Brit with a black panther for a pet. I thought unspeakable terrors were in store, and the animal turns out about as dangerous as an Instagram kitten. The scene where the two women in Narasimha Reddy's life, that is Nayanthara and Tamannaah, meet should have been a dramatic scorcher. It plays out like a corporate handshake. Now, the mega success of the Bahubali film seems to have emboldened filmmakers to make big, really big films. Think big, really big. But very few of them seem to understand that the Bahubali films weren't just about kings and queens and spectacles and costumes and battles. They were about solid writing first. That's what made those films, and then Rajamouli built on that solid writing and made those fantastic movies. Now, there are so many potentially great moments in Sye Raa. A little boy stealing a fistful of grain, a British officer heartlessly procuring dye for a fabric, or even the meeting between two lovers, two future lovers underwater. And these are all potentially great, and there is some genuinely goosefleshy stuff in all of these moments, little by little, but instead of dwelling on these moments, the film keeps hopping to the next one. It seems so restless to kind of get ahead. With a megastar and a mega budget, I hope for a mega movie, and that didn't happen with Sye Raa. The full review is up on the Film Companion website. If you like this video, do subscribe to Film Companion South, and see you soon at the movies.